after the game to me that there was not enough bending of the legs for the boys. It's something they have to learn. A lot of them, again, new to the sport of volleyball. And that bending of the legs, as opposed to moving your arms, a lot of balls put out of play, especially on the harder serves. If you come up against a hard server, you really have to get those legs bent to receive that serve. And it's something that Coach Martin said of the boys' team that they definitely have to work on as the season progresses.
Yeah, and that's really one of those things that it's going to be game practice time, where you really feel it and you see the difference of when you bump a ball only with your arms. And we don't have the tallest ceiling, but it's also not short here in the Loger gym, but they're going to go immediately into the rafters if you're just using your arms. You really, you'd almost have to look at like those weightlifters. They have to put their bottom so low, and they have to have the bend in the knees and push with a straight back. That's really how it, you know, your form has to be, and the arms kind of come with it naturally.
For March 2021. Grade 8, David Willis. David has had great success representing Dr. Loger Middle School in cross country, boys soccer, boys basketball, and is currently a senior member of the boys Tier 1 volleyball team. On the volleyball court, David is comfortable at the net, and he will clearly play a major part of the team's success this season. Grade 8, Lauren Swain. Lauren was a major contributing member of the Dlms Girls Championship Soccer Team, the Tier 1 Girls Basketball Team, and currently the Girls Tier 1 Volleyball Team. On the volleyball court, Lauren has great court sense and is a force at the net. Watch for her to provide lots of exciting plays and fill a leading role in the Knights offense this season.
So we're back after a brief technical difficulty situation. I do want to give a shout out to Mr. Michael McCullum, who is the man behind the scenes here. Often you don't see Mike on camera. Not a fan of the on camera, but a lot of this magnificent production you're seeing in our gym this year is a direct result of the hard work behind the scenes with Mr. Mike McCullum.
Yeah, and I know Mike and I in years past have had conversations about how could we produce live video of games, and honestly, that's one of the, you know, there's few benefits of the pandemic, but it's really one, because we can't accept any fans into our gym, and we definitely want, whether it's home team, road team, grandparent, you know, aunt, uncle, or whoever on the other side of the country, to be able to tune in and see someone here at Dr. Loger, or even just an ASDN, be able to watch a game. So, you know, hats off go to Mike and a lot of his morning announcements crew that are really turning into the video production crew.
Yeah, now this is something I really am looking forward to seeing evolve the post-pandemic. I think it's something, an element that the fans appreciate, the parents appreciate, the greater community appreciates, to be able to tune in and watch some sports through these challenging times. But I think it does have a place beyond the pandemic.
Yeah, it does.
And here we go, folks. We are almost ready to start. Referee has taken her position on the stands. We're just moments away from the opening serve. I'm not sure which team. Likely,
it'd be like a draw of a hat. They'll select a number, and if they select correctly, they'll get their serve. So right now, the head ref is really just double-checking the numbers. So that's why the players are turning around to face. They want to make sure that they have it. And it'll end up being the white team that'll start
off. And it is number 29, Reese Godfrey, with the opening serve. So Reese Godfrey is going to start us with our opening serve. And we're just about ready to start. A little readjustment from our referee here to make sure she's in position to make the right call. Ever referee a volleyball game, Mr. Way?
Never.
Never. Not myself either.
I stick to my lane, which is hockey. After that, no thank you.
And a good overhand serve to start from Godfrey.
And that's the thing, like we talked about earlier, serving in the Tier 2 level is key. You know, a nice overhand serve, not everyone's always ready for it, and I don't think the grade 8s were ready for an overhand serve from the 6-7.
Another good serve from Godfrey. A little bit of spin action, I think, on that serve.
Yeah, and that's what you need to see. That'll give it almost like that tennis or table tennis. It'll give that little dipsy doodle.
Mm-hmm. Try and float. Went in a little off there. A little off. likely maybe not set on the serve on that one, and it went wide. And we're back over to grade 8, tier 2 girls, and it will be Raya Lauren with the serve on this one. Raya Lauren. Number two, Raya Lauren.
And Raya goes with an underhand serve.
And that ball is up, but narrowly misses the rafter. Stays in play. Carly Okoto with it to Raya. Ball's still alive, and a great effort there, but just under the net. And a point to the white team with the white collars, our grade 6-7 girls. Serve. Oh, a little short on that one. A little bit short on that one. And we now have number 12. And
Meredith Perry.
Meredith Perry with the serve. Perry with a nice floating serve. Good reception. Not quite over. See, that's Mr. Way, that popping that ball up there and making the play is where I think the work will be needed to make sure they get that ball over the net. And again, a rafter ball, which we'll see some of, and that's that arm action.
Yeah, and if you really want to think about anyone that's familiar with hockey, it's like a goalie giving out a big rebound. If they kick their leg wide, it gives the team a chance to put one back in the net. But if they can control their rebound and they have control of it, that's what the idea of that bump return is all about, to get it so that you can control where it goes. It stays in the middle, and then your setter can take action.
Brooklyn Kelly now with the serve. Brooklyn Kelly, and a nice serve in, but a good return over the net. A little surprise one there. I don't think they were expecting that.
No.
And a little bit of miscommunication on the 6-7 team, and ball remains with a 5-4 lead for the grade 8 girls right now. Barely clears that one.
That just dances with the rafters.
And it does go in for a point, so it's now 6-4. Kelly with the serve. And I believe that is, I'll wait for the referee's call, that is out.
That's out, yeah.
That was out, but not by much.
No, but when you're standing on that line and you know it's going over the side of you, you're going to have to take that chance.
And I believe this is number 30, Colby Durrell with the serve. And a grade 6 kid just learning a game. And you are going to see a few of those errors creep in with the serving. It's something they have to work on. It's not an easy thing to do. And that's a lot of times when the nerves really set in when they're on the line and they know that the eyeballs are on them. That's a good serve from Carly Okoto.
Good bump by Durrell.
And not quite. And I will say volleyball is a sport where you have to communicate. You have to talk to each other on the court.
Yeah, and you can't assume someone else is going to get it. You have to know where it is, be aggressive, and move.
Oh, a nice serve,
a little
which we call an ace.
A little laser beam right over the top.
And that is an ace for Carly Okoto. I noticed in the boys' game I was calling last night, those ones that just barely get over the net, but they're nice, hard serve. They're hard to pick up as they just barely come over the net.
And really, it becomes the seconds that your brain can react to, is this my ball? Like, and it just takes a different trajectory to get to understand where it's going to land.
Okoto still with the serve here. And again, a little bit of arm action there from Emily Kingston. She got down low on that, but the arms moved a little bit, and you can see what happens when the arms move. The ball typically goes out of play with the arm action. That's a nice bump from Colby Durrell. Ball still alive.
Yeah, Durrell has the right positioning. I think we're going to have a timeout here from the white team.
Yeah, and oftentimes, Mr. Way, it's not probably a bad call when you're starting to have a server that's hot, that's in the zone. And I think we call that icing the server.
Yeah,
is that?
just like the NFL, you ice the kicker just to make them think about it a little bit more. But what it does, similar to basketball, you put a break on the momentum of the team that has the offense. But at the same time, for your defense, you get a little bit of a chance to reset, talk about it. You know, even like the pitching coach going out in baseball and just settling down your pitcher just to remind them they can do it. And, you know, this is just a blip in the radar. Let's get through it, get back to basics, do things the right way, and good things will happen.
And probably not unexpected in the first set. Our grade eights are out to a solid start here. A little more experience on the grade eight team, likely. Some of these girls have likely played volleyball for a couple of years now.
Yep.
Where the 6'7" team, it is a steep learning curve because there is not usually a organized volleyball program at the elementary level. So for a lot of girls coming into Dr. Loger or middle schools around the province for that matter, a lot of times it's brand new to them in grade six.
And that's one of the things why here with the girls, we're running four teams just to expose as many girls to it as possible. But even yourself, when you're supervising at lunch hour, you know, the time in the gym, we have a lot of kids that are playing volleyball, getting it back and forth, crossing it. Like, you can see that the desire to play the game is there. Sometimes it's just a matter of matching up with the proper skill set and the confidence to go out and play in the team.
And it's a testament that Dr. Loger has four girls volleyball teams in action this season, which tells you the interest is there. And as I was saying last night at the boys' game, the interest in the boys' program is starting to grow as well, because that was always an issue. And there's a violation on Godfrey. You've got to remember, Eden, middle school volleyball, you cannot volley a serve.
No, I mean, that's just a volleyball rule. You can't, but that, again, is just all about body positioning. Get yourself into the right spot.
So it looks like Okoto is maybe trying to run the table here, Mr. Way.
I mean, she's definitely on a roll.
That is at least 10 points in a row for the grade 8 girls, the blue team, the Blue Knights.
The Blue Knights, yeah.
The Blue Knights. And Okoto is going to try and keep the momentum going here. She's on a roll. Let's see what we got.
You know, all the white team needs, though, is they just need to get a serve back and get it over. Because sometimes when you watch that many unreturned serves come over, sometimes, you know, you kind of fall on your heels and just expect to get the next point. Everyone kind of has to stay ready. So I think if the white team can get one back across, maybe they can start to swing the momentum and get served back for them.
So we had a substitution. And that one barely clears the rafters. Godfrey with the return. Let's see what we have. Good call. And they still keep the ball there. There was a little bit of action on that one. Okoto still with the serve. And we are at 17-5 in set number one. And there's the first miscue for Carly Okoto. Solid round of serving there from Okoto. And we're back over to the... And that is wide, and that is, I believe...
Catherine Wilson.
Catherine Wilson with the serve, and just a bit wide on the serve.
So we have Abigail Nicholson going to serve for the
number
blue team.
Three, Abigail Nicholson, a little bit too much arm action maybe on that serve, Mr. Way, and then I'm sure she gets a little more practice at it.
Yeah,
big, powerful girl. They're a tall girl with lots of athleticism.
Yeah, and I mean, we were talking about the composition of the teams. It's Abigail's first time even playing on a team, let alone a volleyball team. So you can definitely see that the composition of the teams is quite different, but we're really happy to see people like Abigail coming out to play, because we want to make sure that everyone has a team to play on. Regardless of their situation.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm glad to see some kids out that maybe haven't had an opportunity to play on a team sport, because it is important. And again, a little bit of miscommunication, and that seems to be a running theme in the first set. More communication maybe on the grade 8 side. That's probably the experience factor coming into play.
Yeah, I mean, Sophie there, she bumped the ball, and she just not ready to, actually, she has to move out of the way, and someone has to come in and get it. She bumped it straight up, which was good.
Look at, there's a good play, though. She redeemed herself on that one, and now scored a point for her team, and they regained service. And we have number 33, Addison McDonald, with the serve. Addison with a good serve. Little bit of a rally underway here. Ball is still in play, and that is wide. And after a good serve, they do score a point on that one.
And I know Coach Cable on the blue team side is going to be encouraging her girls to have multiple hits, not just play that game of it comes over, get it back over. She wants them to start controlling the ball.
That is definitely true.
Oh, good try.
And that is a net violation, I believe, as well on that one. It didn't make it over anyway, but I believe there was some net violation involved there.
Yeah, Catherine tried to volley it over, but her hand just landed into the net.
Served by Meredith Perry there.
And then the rafters got Nicholson on that.
Okay.
So she tried to bump it, and it touched the rafters, so it'll go point over to the white team. So McDonald keeps her serve.
And it in, the white team trying to mount a little bit of a comeback here. No, we are now to, I think, who do we have serving, Mr. Way?
Sophie Savoy.
Sophie Savoy with the serve.
Oh, trick shot.
And that is going wide, I believe. And it is the white team mounting a little bit of a comeback here.
Yeah, so we're now at 21-12 for the blue. And that's a nice
that
little serve.
That is a nice little serve.
Just getting over.
Godfrey with a big play there, and Godfrey gets the point.
That was just over by a whisker.
Savoy with the serve. Oh! Now, I don't know the call on that one. A net violation,
yeah, so
I believe.
Yeah, so Carly would end up with a net violation on that just because she carried it up.
Yeah.
So it wasn't a true bump. It was a carry.
And I am not going to lie to you folks here. This is a comeback in the works. We were down. The white team was down, but we are now getting back into this game after some solid serving from Sophie. Sav, another one just barely carries
the net. Oh,
she's
just clipping this.
And that's
nice
a good bump. So
nice
what do we
bump.
Got? Okay. Now this is a little bit better volleyball happening
there you
right
go.
Now.
Got some, yeah, that's
and there it is to stop the rally. Rhea Lauren, I believe, with the play on that one to bring the ball back to her side. And we have Brooklyn Kelly with the serve. Looks excited to get the serve underway. That's a good serve.
Oh.
And immediately back over.
Godfrey just sends it over across the top of the net, and the blue team's unable to return it.
So it's 22-16.
So we have Reese McDonald here ready to serve.
And that is going to make it over. Tough serve. Good play by Okoto. Oh, man, that's Alexis Kingston with a little tip over the net. Yeah. I think she flubbed that one a little bit, got a little lucky on that one.
Yeah, off the fingertips, but it does the trick.
And Okoto keeps the ball alive. Oh, and a rafter ball.
Yeah, rafter ball, but at the same time, Carly did do a great job of putting it back in play where they could get it over.
And we have a four-point game here, folks. I'm not sure. I think probably didn't wait for the whistle on that one.
Yeah, just waiting on the whistle.
And another serve that is just clearing the net. So what do we got? A little bit of back and forth here. That's a good set. This is
three hits.
Mrs. Cable will be happy to see that.
We're going to have two hits back. Nice set and over.
Ella Guimond and... We have a three-point game. A little bit of confidence now being felt on the other side of the court. You can almost feel it in the gym now. The tide has turned.
I think the blue team just took a timeout here. I think Cable just took a TO.
Yeah, Cable is obviously feeling what I'm feeling, which is the tide has turned in this match. It was a one-point, at least a 15-point lead for the blue team. And now our grade 6, 7, tier 2 girls have mounted a comeback, and we are into a three-point game in the first set.
You know, like we were talking earlier about communication, but sometimes it's about staying present and in the game. You kind of get caught up as a fan when the play is not coming to you. It's like, you know, when you and I would see baseball at the peewee level early, sometimes the right fielder is like a... Like, you know, is a part of the stands, and then all of a sudden one's hit to them and they don't even react because they kind of forget that, you know, a ball hasn't come to them in two innings, but all of a sudden they have a big part and cutting down three runs. So I think that's the point when someone gets on a roll on serve, not being an observer and kind of being present and knowing your role and always being ready for the ball to come to you.
And the wily veteran coach Cable with the timeout there, and it paid off for with a point to the grade 8 girls that gets the hands back in the ball and that. The ball back in the hands of Okoto, who had a great run earlier in the game, with the chance to end the set here. It is set point. Carly Okoto with a chance to end the set here with one serve.
Two nice hits, three over.
That's Alexis Kingston.
Beautiful. Nice set.
And miscommunication on it. And, folks, that does end. Full credit to Mrs. Krista Cable with the timeout, a timely timeout, as the tide was certainly turning in that match. And we now have...
I think you can see that, you know, at this level, serve is almost, you know, the indicator of momentum. Everyone gets a little bit more excited when their team makes two or three in a row, and they're placed, you know, well. You know, we had a couple that were just grazing the top of the net from Sophie Savoie, and that really swung momentum on the white team side. So it'll be interesting now when we get our second round, our second set, when we see more of the players from each roster get in. It'll be almost like a B version of the first set. Well, they'll have to get through the first set of nerves for them, get the first serves over across, but also communicate, get down in your stance, and be ready and expect that the ball's coming to you and knowing what you're going to do if it does come to you.
Yes. Now, if you were just tuning in, the first set was won by the Grade 8, the Dr. Loge Blue Knights. The girls took the set 25-19, at one point out to a commanding lead, but the 6-7, the white girls, the Grade Dr. Loge Grade 6-7 White Knights, fought back in that one and made it a real close set, and we're hoping for more of the same in set number two, which is momentarily about to begin. I'm sure we'll have a little bit of different configuration on the floor in this one, likely some players that didn't get a chance to see the game the first time around, and it is, I see Ella Howe, making her way onto the floor.
Ella Gima as well.
Madison Gauguin. We have Sophie Savoie back on the floor, and I believe
Reese McDonald back out in the
Reese
floor.
Reese McDonald.
And Taryn Malby.
Taryn Malby, that's who the new addition is on the floor. So for the White Knights, it is Madison Gauguin, Reese McDonald, Sophie Savoie, Ella Howe, Taryn Malby, and Ella Guimond. Couple of Ellas on the floor.
I'm just going to say, so now you watch, because the Blue Knights are going to be probably five Brooklyns. The Brooklyns.
We do have an inordinate amount of Brooklyns at Dr. Loge. Yeah. 100%. I believe one class might have four Brooklyns. Now, that might be a record.
And the funny thing is for once, they all spell it the same way.
Okay, well, that's interesting. That's interesting. So on the floor for the Blue Knights, we do have Brooklyn Gregan. Samantha Fernandes gets into the game, number 26. We have Brooklyn Sargent, number 8. We have Madison Sanford. We have Avery Hunter, number 25. And
number 23, Emma Pelche.
Emma Pelche, number 23. So we do have a different configuration on the floor here for set two. Mrs. Cable giving some getting some last minute instructions from the referee. I hope she's not chirping the referee.
Well, I was just going to say, I think she might be appearing to grease the referee maybe for a call or two.
We'll see. A little bit of John McEnroe in her, maybe, Mr. Way, with the side official.
Well, it's interesting that you say that, because I'd in some ways, I'd be proud, but some ways I'd be disappointed if that's the way that it went. I've been known when I was on the other side of the ice, not on the official side, to get a little animated as well. You have as well.
As have I. You as know. Have I.
And sometimes a game needs that, but then other times you got to know when to cool it.
Yeah. Cool your jets, as they say.
Yeah.
So that was a opening serve from Avery Hunter, and it's a good one. We're a 1-0 lead. And again, there it is. You'll see that a few times probably in this match. You cannot volley a serve in middle school volleyball. It must be bumped. Any idea why that's a rule, Mr. Way? Do you have any insight on why you can't volley the serve? Is there any?
I wouldn't know the reason why. I can tell you from a standpoint of teaching is you want them down in the stance and it has to be bumped. I think it comes from the point of when they get taller in men's and women's, you don't want them smashing back against a serve. I think it's a way that forces the defense to bump, because a set just like an overhand spike you know, it just blocks the ability for that serve now to come across.
As we bring back into play here, that was three hits for the 6-7 team, and that was a terrific one that gets them back into the game. It's 3-2. And a little bit of a throw on that one, and it didn't quite work. I'm not sure if that would have counted anyway. That's almost like a double hit, I would think.
Yeah, that's a carry,
yeah.
Because it's staying in your palm.
True.
Oh, it's just a perfectly placed serve.
Yeah.
It's so hard to judge if that's going to go across the top or if it's going to clip or not.
And that is number 25, Madison Gauguin, with that serve that is well placed. And another one in. Oh, catches the top of the net, doesn't quite make it over. It would have been almost an identical serve to the first one, and those are tough.
Yeah.
But you are playing with fire on those because some of them do not make it over the net.
You know, it's that old.
That's another three hit there for the six, and it pays off. Three hits pays off.
And more often than not, it's going to pay off because it allows you to set up where you want to put it. You're not reacting to the ball coming across the net. You're really taking control and then going back on the offense. You know, it's like serving. You don't want to put it in the same spot every time. It's kind of one of those, you know, variety is the spice of life. Well, it's also a good idea in your serving game as well to kind of mix it up where you put it on the court.
Yeah, Alahau with the serve there, just a little bit wide. I sound a little bit like Bob Uecker on that one, Mr. Way. Just a bit outside. Emma Pelche with the hit, and not quite. Good try on that serve, but it didn't quite have the mustard, as they say, and didn't quite make it.
A lot of baseball references thus far early in the match here.
And it is opening day in the Major League Baseball circuit today. It is opening day. I know that it's been a tough year in sports in general, but it is exciting to see them pushing through and finding a way to play. And it is opening day today, and I'm sure there are several people probably in front of their TV watching opening day baseball action in the Major League Baseball circuit, but we are here at the Dr. Loge Gymnasium, and the score is 8-5 for the White Knights. Our grade 6-7 have jumped out to the lead in the second set. Let's see if they can keep it going.
For those of you that are just tuning in past the 5 o'clock hour, you're live here at the Dr. Loge Gymnasium. We have our grade 8 girls of the Tier 2 team. They're called the Blue Knights. And our 6-7 girls are the White Knights, taking on each other. We're live in the second set. Currently, we're at 9, serving 5 for the White Knights.
And Brooklyn Gregan takes over here. Point to the Blue Knights here. Gregan's going to see if she can go on a run. I know she does have a powerful serve. We'll see if she uses it. Oh, just misses. Tried to put a little spin on that one, I think, Mr. Wayne. It didn't quite pay off for her.
No, and that's the thing. That's the risk-reward with the overhand serve, is you got to put that spin. It's going to go right over the top of the net, and you just dance with that every time.
And that's a serve wide. I'm not quite see. I couldn't see.
That was Taryn Malpe.
Taryn Malpe with the serve on that one. Just a little bit wide. And we have Samantha Fernandes here, 26, and she's going to try and serve. And it's a good one. And it pays off for her. No, it doesn't pay off for her. That was over the net and couldn't quite get that ball back in play.
And that's where that excitement of, I just want to get it back over, want to get it back over comes in.
Yeah. A little bit of patience required on those. Making sure that you set yourself, pop that ball up for your teammate. And we'll see here. Brooklyn Sargent now with the serve for the Blue Knights.
Nice. Beautiful serve.
And it does pay off for Brooklyn Sargent. See if she can get her team back in the game here. 2-point lead for the White Knights. Sargent with another good serve. Little different serve on that one.
Yeah, floater that time.
A floater.
Little change up.
Which is not a bad thing. Try and mix your serves up as a pitcher. Back to the baseball references. As a pitcher would mix up their pitches, you might want to mix up your serves in volleyball. And that's a good one. And a rafter hit from Malpe, and we have a tie game, 11-11.
And that's how the momentum swings that quick.
Sargent with the hit, another beautiful floating serve. And And not quite that time by Madison. Oh, that's Avery Hunter. Tried to get the hit on that one, but into the net it goes. And we now have Reese McDonald serving for the White Knights. Barely clears the net, and it does pay off for out to a two-point lead. And we'll see if Reese McDonald can maybe go on a little run here. Another serve. And that might
that's,
have been
you know, the ahead. Second time in a row that one came to Madison Sanford, and she was down on the ground bumping it. It was nice to see.
Yeah, and tries to go with the soccer play on that one with the kick, and that, I believe, is that a legal play?
That is, it is legal. Yeah. However, as long as it doesn't get, it's the same as going down in your stomach now. Hunter gets it across that time. Now we're going back and forth like the radio dial on a Clary Hale forward.
That is a terrific reference. Well, I'm not sure if we have any fans listening from the other side of the river, but that is a terrific reference. We have Avery Hunter with the serve. That is three hits. They couldn't quite get a solid hit on that one, but it does pay off for them. And we are now in a one-point game, I believe.
You know, Greg, if I actually take a second while Avery's yes. serving here, and I want to actually thank her father, Drew, because I had two friends last night, both from the Moncton area, that were calling a junior A game last night in Campbellton.
Yes.
Called me. They had car trouble. Couldn't rent a car because Enterprise was out of vehicles. They were literally stuck on the side of the road with the alternator on their car. Couldn't be fixed. They ended up at Mark Bowe's Auto.
Wow.
And we ended up getting a hold of Chrysler, and mm-hmm. that's why I thank Drew, because they were able to rent a vehicle from Chrysler, get to Campbellton, call the game, which was against the Timberwolves, by the way,
yes,
and made it home safe and sound. So I just want to give a shout-out to all the guys and gals down at Town Chrysler, because I know you guys really helped out some of my buddies.
Well, that's terrific, and that is what I will equate to living in a small town. You see that kind of stuff in a small town, people stepping up to help each other, especially our local businesses. So it's nice to see that. And that is a bit of a rally on the ball here, and it pays off for the Blue Knights.
Yep, so now we'll have Madison Sanford going to come to serve.
Madison Sanford with a good serve. And that's a good good bump by Ella Guimond. And just
up into the lights.
Raises the lights. And again, it's that arm action. Moving the arms a little bit too much on the hit. And that's a great serve. That's
I remember in my junior high days, I'm from the other side of the river, so I was a product of that time of Harkins Junior High, and we had the smallest gym in history, if anyone ever remembers.
I played a little bit of floor hockey in that gym.
Yeah, but we did have a really high ceiling, but I can remember the late, great Jimmy Graham. He taught everyone, it didn't matter what it was, you always did volleyball as part of your phys ed regime, and he just taught you the basics and how to do it, and I can just remember just being low down in the stance, learning how to do that, and it really came in later, you know, when I played at different levels, but even just really different gyms that had lower ceilings, and, you know, you weren't bumping them into the ceiling the whole time.
Fun fact, Jimmy Graham was the golf partner of Bernie Keating.
Really?
Yes, he was. A longtime golf partner in the Monday Night Men's League of Bernie Keating. So I do know Mr. Graham quite well, and I know he was well respected at the Harkins, and not just Harkins, provincial level as a coach and a mentor. Just a great, great human being overall, Mr. Jimmy Graham, who's no longer with us.
Now, unlike Bernie, did Jimmy finish any of his putts, or was it the round based on speed or on score?
I believe Jimmy was kind of the yin to Bernie's yang, if you will. he kept him in check, because speed is certainly one of the contributing factors to why my father plays the game of golf.
Ready golf.
Ready golf. So we are in a match here, folks. It's a two-point lead, and Brooklyn Dragon with a little bit of a miscue on her serve, and we are to a one-point game. We are in a match here. Second set, it's 20-19 for the Blue Knights.
Taryn Mulvey with an overhand
serve. And again, the arm action a little too much on that one, and it's into the rafters, which extends the Blue Knights to to a two-point lead, and the ball is in the hands of Samantha Fernandes, who I believe, is this Samantha's first year playing, Mr. Wade?
Yeah, first year as well. It's excellent to see her out playing.
Yeah. So the serve.
She feathers one.
That is... Oh,
Point for the Blue Knights.
Point for the Blue Knights. I believe I may have saw some... The net is definitely moving on that one, but no call on the referee.
Well, it's no problem if the ball hits. It's all about the hands. So the ball can rebound off the net. It just can't have any players run into it.
True enough. And that's likely why I saw that net moving. It was the ball action, not the hands.
Yep.
So it is 22-20 for the Blue Knights. We are in a very close second set. And it just got closer. It's now 22-21. The ball will be over to the White Knights, and I'm just going to wait to see who's going to be serving here.
Yeah, I think they might have to do a rotation, and they, of course, let it roll right back to the wall. So Sophie Savoy has her serve.
Okay, and Sophie's going to try and make something happen here with the serve, and it is a good one, but that's a good bump from Sanford, but a miscommunication on the Blue Knight side, and we have a tie game in the second set. And we will see if Sophie Savoy can get her team the second set here, the victory in the second set. Another good serve and another point.
It is definitely gut check time. Everyone is tightening up a little bit more. It's all about right now getting that serve back across the net.
Yeah, and we are down to the wire here. It's 23-22 with the ball in the hands of Sophie Savoy. And another good serve. We'll see what can happen here.
There it is.
It does.
Bump gets across. Right in a good spot. Defense isn't ready. Point for the Blue.
Point for Blue. And we have Brooklyn Sargent with the serve. And she did have a good serving set the last time she came around. So we'll see what she can do here. Brooklyn Sargent with the serve. Another good one. And this could be it. We have a one-point lead. You have to win by two. Am I correct on that, Mr. Wade?
Yeah, so could be a set.
That could be set serve. Sargent with the ball in her hand. See if she can end it here. And it is a good one, but it's a good return. That is called out by the referee.
Out.
So that was close, Mr. Way. If we had video review on that, I would love to see the video review.
Well, I don't know how many iPads that's going to cost me, but we'll have to put that on Executive Director McCollum, see if we can get a live-action review.
And I do want to thank Miss Lindsay Reed, who just delivered the two commentators. A little bit of Tim Hortons action here, and we're going to...
Enjoy a beverage.
I don't know if I should be promoting any company's products on screen, but we're going to see. I will say that was a very close ball, that last one to win the game for the Blue Knights.
It's one of those, every sport has its own way that you play across the line. You know, you think of football, to get to the end zone, you just got to clip the line. In hockey, the puck totally has to cross the line, you know. So it's always how it is, but the volleyball is so big, that probably did land out, but it's just, you know, it almost looks like it clips the line.
From my angle, it did look like it clipped the line, and if it does clip the line, that would have been in.
Yep.
But ultimately, I am not the referee, so I do not make the final call on that one.
You asked me earlier if I have any experience in volleyball, and the answer is no. I stick to my lane in hockey. I know that set of rules quite well. And as Mrs. O'Neill, one of our new staff members, always comments, the Timberwolves have a fighting chance as long as I'm not on the ice, which makes me feel good that I know I'm not a homer.
Dr. Loger Middle School is proud to present the Athletes of the Month for March 2021. Grade 8 David Williston. David has had great success representing Dr. Loger Middle School in cross country, boys soccer, boys basketball, and is currently a senior member of the boys Tier 1 volleyball team. On the volleyball court, David is comfortable at the net, and he will clearly play a major part of the team's success this season. Grade 8 Lauren Swain. Lauren was a major contributing member of the Dlms Girls Championship Soccer Team the Tier 1 girls basketball team, and currently the girls Tier 1 volleyball team. On the volleyball court, Lauren has great court sense and is a force at the net. Watch for her to provide lots of exciting plays and fill a leading role in the Knights offense this season.
And we are back, folks, for set number 3. And if, in case you're just joining us, the Blue Knights took a very close second set, 25-23. And they are up 2-0 on the White Knights, which is composed of our grade 6-7 girls. And the grade 8 girls is who we're calling the Blue Knights here. The Blue Knights are composed of grade 8 girls. And that's a serve from Reese Godfrey to start us off in the third set. Let's see if she gets the point, and she does get the point. They couldn't quite get coordinated there to get the ball back over. And Reese
Godfrey. I can tell that Coach Cable was definitely encouraging some three hits, just the way that they attacked that return and tried to set it back. They're definitely looking to get some three sets.
And there's a little bit of the nerves there you can see on Reese Godfrey. A little bit anxious at the line there and didn't quite set herself, and the ball didn't quite make it. I am thoroughly impressed with Brooklyn Sargent's serving game. Number 8, Brooklyn Sargent. Beautiful serves.
Oh, just perfectly placed.
And that is an ace, folks. Exact same spot. So the 6-7 White Knights are going to have to adjust to that, because that was almost a carbon copy of the serve before it.
Yeah, Godfrey really just has to take control in that situation and call it and let the front court know that she has it and get it up in the air.
And now Brooklyn Sargent has reset herself here. Oh, my. Another ace that just clears the net. So she is changing it up on her serve here. She started on one side of the court, and now she's kind of feeding it over to the other side of the court. And look at this. Placing the ball, and it pays off again. Little too much arm action there from Addison McDonald on that one, and the ball goes into the rafters. Another serve from Sargent. Ball doesn't make it.
You know something I noticed two serves ago, though, even though the points are staying with the blue team, you can see the white team starting to talk to each other. They want to move in because they see that she's putting them all in a general spot.
That is, and that is a ball returned over the net there. We'll see if it pays off for the White Knights. That's two hits. And that's going to have to go over, and it does. A little bit.
Well, that was just went to the back. You know, it's one of those things where it feels like it's going to go over your head, so you do whatever you can do to try and get it back over. And, you know, it's a score that goes to 25. You're gonna make some mistakes, and it's just how you react and how you overcome it next time. So it's probably a good time for a timeout, just, again, that ice the kicker mentality. Let's freeze her out, make her think about it, and let's reset and decide on her strategy and remind those young grade 6s and 7s that, you know, they have the skills. Don't get it, you know, get it out of your head. It's not the end of the world that a couple of serves fell in. It's how to react to the next one and always be ready. It's like the, you know, getting ready to putt in golf. It's that mental thing of what am I going to do this time? You know, it's about this shot, not about the last one.
Some more great insight there from our color commentator, Mr. Way, on how to get your head into the game. And thinking about the next play. We have Brooklyn Sargent with the serve, and her serving game has been on point so far this game. This set, it is pretty much all Brooklyn Sargent at the moment. Just placing those serves in and finding the holes.
You know, when they get on these runs, it kind of reminds me of a Wimbledon tennis match where the server just gets on a roll and there's not many returns. It's all about the number of aces that you can get.
Yeah, and it's, again, if you've got a player on your team that has that confidence in their serve, and it appears that Brooklyn Sargent does have that confidence in her serve, she doesn't even look like she's thinking about it. She's just stepping up and knowing that her skill is there to hit the ball, and going ahead and doing it. And that's oftentimes the only way to get that is with practice.
That's right. You know, it's almost like a Serena Williams serve. It's all about trying to break her serve to give you a chance, because she's going to make so many great ones. It's just trying to find those opportunities and know how you're going to react, and never assuming that you're going to, you know, that it's going to take advantage of you. You got to take advantage of it.
And that is the first miscue on Brooklyn Sargent, who went on quite a run there and gets her team out to a commanding 14-2 lead in set number three. And we'll see if the White Knights can somehow try and get themselves back in this game. It is Addison McDonald serving, and it's a good one. We'll see, and that's three hits. Look it.
Oh, that's a nice way to do it. Okay, they're going to try two. It again. Get it back over.
And oh. Not quite, but I do hear Mrs. Cable on the sideline. She does want to see those three hits, which is a real good strategy. And actually being up this big in the set and already being up two in the match, it is a good strategy to get your players used to making those three hits before they put that ball. Addison McDonald with the serve. We'll see.
Kingston with the set, but over Wilson's head.
And a little bit too aggressive maybe on that set.
It's all nerves. It's all how your body flows and being comfortable with it.
And that is a bit of panic there on the White Knights. Carly Yokoto now. See what she can do. Underhand serve to Emily Kingston. That is in play. And it's a point for the Blue Knights.
Yep.
17-4 here, folks, in set three.
I think we're going to see a substitution on the White side.
And we are. Who do we have coming into the game, Mr. Way?
Sophie Savoy and Ella Guima.
Okay, Ella Guima, number 35, and number 7, Sophie Savoy, join into the game here and see if they can make a difference here for their team. That is a good return from Alexis Kingston, but not quite able to pay it off on that one. And Yokoto retains her serve here. Ball over the net. And again, you can see clearly, I know we talked about this before the game began, serving is key in volleyball. If you can get your serve in and get on a run, you really give your team a chance to pull off the W.
And really for the White team, what better experience than having a grade 8 that can serve, pushing you to get better?
Yeah.
The only way you're going to get better is by practicing it and having it happen in real time. It's not, you know, perfect practice is best. So what better than a game?
Yeah. And this is it. You're making sure if you got somebody putting that ball in play, you have to learn to get yourself set, get those knees bent, and get ready to make sure that you bump that ball in a place where your teammates can get to it. And that is another one of those unforced errors, which is a volley on the serve, which the referee blows down immediately.
And it's one of those where Savoy would have set it, and as soon as she touched it, says, oh, I got a bump.
Well, there's three hits for the White Knights, the first one in a while for them.
And Sanford again, tips it across.
And it is, again, a lot of experience here, I think, paying off here for the Blue Knights. And Carly Yokoto with another good serve. And that's a point now for the White Knights, who stave off elimination here with a timely point, and we'll see if they can make something happen here. 24-5.
And Savoy can get on a roll here with her serve.
That is true. Oh, big one from
Catherine Wilson.
I was going to say her mother is Kara Wilson, but that's not. Certainly, if Kara's listening, that was not Kara Wilson who made that. That was Catherine Wilson, her daughter. A little bit of a rally underway here. And that is the set for the Blue Knights. So if you're counting at home, that does give the match to the Blue Knights. That is 3-0. So technically the match is over, but typically for practice and for sportsmanship, they do play it out. They play the full five.
Yeah, so at 15. The middle school level, because we want to make sure that they get as much court time as possible. So they always play the five sets.
Yeah, which is good. The more touches, I would say the same thing. I coach soccer. The more touches you get, the better you're going to get.
Yeah.
Same if I was alluding to the hockey. The more times you have the puck on your stick, the better you're going to get at the game of hockey, which is why they actually changed the rules at the younger level in hockey and have completely gone to the modified ice surface for that very purpose of making sure that kids get those touches and get better at the game.
And I think it's important to understand at the developmental level, the point is to develop young athletes, and it's not always about the W.
Yeah.
It's not always about, you know, running home and counting your points and, you know, how good am I compared to the other person. It's all about their own personal development, and the only way that they're going to get better, whether it's volleyball, hockey, golf, whatever, is repetition and getting out there in game situations and playing, you know, a game. But, I mean, if you're a junior golfer, there's no sense of standing back at the blue tees and barely getting it off the tee deck. You know, the point is to get it out there because, you know, it's about fun, but it's about development. Get it out into the fairway, hit the green, and make some putts. There's nothing worse than taking 10 strokes to get all the way to the green just because you're not playing, you know, at a court that's decent for you. That's really the same kind of concept where we have here. And even at the Tier 3 level, we play, it is volleyball, but it's a triple ball set of rules where they actually can catch the ball and move it around. It would be almost a version that I would have played with Jimmy Graham called Nukem Ball.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's not as much emphasis on bumping and, you know, it's about teaching them to pass it. So the triple is that idea, the three passes on your side to get it back over.
I got you. Okay. So that I did not know that. Some more great color commentary there from Mr. Judson Way, giving you a little insight into triple ball, which is played by our youngest players at the middle school level. We are now into set four, and it is Reese McDonald serving for the White Knights, and they jump out to a quick two-point lead. Let's see if this maybe is a little bit of a feel-good story here in the fourth set for our White Knights, who are definitely lacking in experience, but maybe this will be something that they can go home today and feel good about themselves. No one there.
No, that's just that's communication. Just understand who has the ball.
Mm-hmm. And that is where somebody does have to take charge on that. Likely someone from the back court, I believe, Mr. Way. Is that when the ball's coming?
Yeah, so it's understanding it's over their head and but really calling for it. It's like that your center fielder in baseball really taking charge, saying who has it and that priority like a shortstop or a center fielder to say that they got it because they're up the middle.
Okay. And that was three hits, but unfortunately it goes wide there. Guimond put it wide, and we are back to the Blue Knights. It is Avery Hunter with the serve. And that is well short. Missed that one. And it is going to be Madison Gauguin serving for the White Knights. See if Gauguin can do something here. That's a good serve. Nice hard serve. And that's a good play there from
three
Abigail,
in the tip across by
Abigail
Fernandes.
Nicholson with the set on that one. Real good play.
And Samantha with the big fist pump afterwards. Way to go.
A little short on the serve, and I think that is something that, being new to the sport, Abigail can definitely work on that as her serve, but she did make a real nice play in the play before that. And a little miscommunication there.
You know, we've been using other sports for comparison, but I mean, you really think of a center fielder, like you brought up, like a Troy Godfrey kind of type.
Yeah.
The big thing is to be that field general and to let everyone know. And what I'm kind of noticing so far, now that we're in the fourth set, that's the little bit of experience that the grade eights have over the 6-7 is someone on the court will kind of take control, and they don't have the long strings of being kind of down or having a hard time getting it back across the net. It's really because they have that center fielder that's kind of stepping in and taking control. And depending on which set we're in, it kind of turns into different people. But it's good to see, and that's going to be that next step for the grade 6-7 white team, is to kind of have that confidence and someone take charge out there.
And I have noticed throughout the match, too, with the experience on the grade 8 side, the confidence in the serves are definitely stronger on the grade 8 side. They're a lot of them, I can see the tentativeness when the 6-7s step up to hit their serve, where I'm not seeing that near as much with our grade 8s. A lot of confidence at the line and knowing that they're just trusting their instincts, I guess, that the ball, they have the ability to put that ball in play, and that's exactly what they're doing. Okay.
Ella gets it across.
Ella gets it across, finds a hole there. I think she was actually pretty excited about that one. I think she saw the hole and the ball went exactly where she meant to put it, and it pays off for her.
And that's a big thing, is to recognize that you've done it well and to put it where you wanted to do it, and you have that sense of satisfaction.
Yeah, and it is important to recognize, have your head in the game and knowing where, okay, I see a spot on there, there's nobody there, I'm going to put the ball in that place. And if you can do that, feels good when you do it. So Guimond now with a serve. We have a two-point game. A little bit of a miss on that one. I think the ball rolled off her hand. She tried to get a hit on that, and it didn't quite work out.
Yeah, right off the edge of the fingers.
Mm-hmm. Samantha Fernandes now with the serve. Let's see what Samantha has. Good serve there from Fernandes, and it is out of play, so I believe the ball is still Samantha's, or am
yeah,
I wrong?
When Brooklyn Kelly tried to, when she bumped that back across, it was outside of the marker, so it would have been out of bounds.
Those markers, I see that now. That's exactly what happened on that one. Okay, and Tara Malpe tried to serve there, but again, didn't quite make it over the net, so it is Brooklyn Kelly now with the serve. Kelly, and again, wide of the mark.
Yeah, right off the side of the thumb. So who do we have now?
A little bit of encouragement there to her squad from Coach Cable. We have Sophie Savoie with the serve, number 7. Sophie has gone on a run once in this match, so we'll see if she can do it here again.
Yeah, she kind of has that three-quarter from the side, so it probably comes off on a different angle.
Yeah, and that is true, and that is barrel. Just inside the marker there.
Hunter gets it over, and then Gauguin pushes it back, and it lands out of bounds, so it's going to be a point for the blue team.
And now we're to Rhea Lauren, number 2 Lauren here with the serve, see what she has. Oh, little unfortunate on that one. It was a decent set there from McDonald.
And then Ella just kind of got into a match with the net.
That is wide of the mark as well there. And we're into at least another tight one here in the fourth set. We'll see if it is exciting as that second set, because that second set was certainly the most exciting set of the match here. And again, I can hear Coach Guimond.
I was just going to say the same thing. You can tell that they're really starting to let them know.
Mm-hmm. Because there is some miscommunication going on. Not unexpected with a young team. There is some miscommunication going on, and the coach is certainly letting them know to make sure they're ready and filling those holes.
And Madison Gauguin just clips the top of the net, and it ends up staying on her own side. So that'll end up being a point for the Dr. Loger blue team. And now we have Abigail Nicholson, who's up for serve. And almost a carbon copy of what just happened. She just clips the top of the net, and that'll be a point for the white team. And now we're going to go back over to Ella Howe, who's going to have the serve.
Okay.
Now Meredith Perry is going to step up, and she'll have serve.
So Perry with the serve. We'll see what Perry has here. And that's another beautiful one, just clear in the top of the net.
You know, when we've seen some of the struggles with not setting it off the bump, and that's one of those that's just going to go over their head, and the other person doesn't kind of take charge from the backcourt and come in and call them off.
Yeah, and there's another one of those, I guess, throwing the hands at the ball instead of letting the ball come to you, and the ball goes deep into the backcourt and unfortunately unplayable. And again, a little too much arm action there from Gauguin, and ball goes skyward into the rafters.
I have to say, I never ever looked up and thought the rafters were that low, but now there's so many balls that I see hitting up there, maybe I have to give Mr. Tim Dunn a call and see if we can raise the roof.
I know, maybe with that cancellation of the Centennial Bridge raising, we can get the redirect some of that funding to raising the roof of Dr. Loge Middle School.
And getting it to stop leaking.
Now, I'm not sure if federal money would be applied to a provincial school, but we'll see if you can work your magic.
How was the sentiment around the community when that was announced that the bridge wasn't going to shut down?
Well, I know there was a lot of anxiety over how that was going to work in the community with the main artery through the city being shut from the north to the south. That is our main connector from the north to the south. I grew up with that bridge. I was not alive, nor were you, during the ferry days. And there was a lot of talk of how they would make that happen. I don't know if it's completely canceled. I just think the funding from the Higgs government has never been finalized on how they're going to complete that bridge project, which needs to be completed.
And I really think, like you talked about, that idea of it being an artery, I think it's okay to go ahead with the project. You just have to have another way to flow traffic from essentially the edge of Highway 8 on the Bathurst Highway side all the way through to Highway 11 in the Napan side, and until that's completed, it's more prudent just to hold off.
Yeah, and I mean, the bridge is certainly not getting any younger. They have done a complete paint job on the bridge, and some of the piers underneath have been completely redone. But there are the Douglastown side of that bridge is still waiting to be finished, and they also do have to put all new undercarriage of the bridge, which is where it's going to need to be lifted. And I wouldn't even want to know the engineering behind that lifting of a bridge, but it must be something. Okay, back on here, we have a tighter match, but still the Blue Knights are still out in somewhat of a commanding lead. It is 23-16, and Brooklyn Kelly with the ball in her hand. And we'll see if she can make it happen here. No. Good return there from Catherine Wilson.
And you know, the really nice thing there, Brooklyn was unable to return it, but Rhea Lauren looked back there and said, hey, no problem.
Yeah, hey, that's a good teammate. Okay. 5-point game here. Again, the ball is being served by Sophie Savoie. Let's see if that sidewinder serve can make something happen here. And there it is. And it is going to work. Now, if I put myself in the shoes of a server here, and I know I'm serving it to someone that maybe doesn't quite have that confidence, you probably want to hit that spot all day long, right?
Every time.
So let's see what we have here. Nice effort there from Rhea Lauren, but it doesn't quite pay off.
If Sophie manages to mount the comeback, we might have to rename her the Redmondville Ringer.
The Redmondville Ringer. That is possible. And there it is.
And you can see it in the body language after, you know, it doesn't work there. Unfortunately for Avery, she couldn't get it across, and she was just trying, but, you know, then they realize.
And there it is again. A little bit of a run here for the White Knights.
Yeah, so we're actually down to 22, serving 23. 1-point gap.
And that's a good play there from Rhea Lauren, recognizing there that the White Knights weren't set in the front, and just put that ball back over, and they have a chance here to once again end the match. It's the ball is in the hands of Rhea Lauren, and this could do it.
And that'll
and
do it.
And there it is. An unforced error to end that match, which was another volley on the serve. Young grade 6 Ella Howe there, and I'm sure her coach will let her know and let her, the more you play, the more you're going to recognize that that's a no-no in volleyball. You cannot volley on a serve.
You know, Greg, you're a coach, and mm-hmm. First I want to say thank you, you know, for the service that you do here at the school with intramurals and soccer, but also you coach in the community, both baseball and hockey, you mm-hmm. know, even if it's just in a supporting role. But you'd have to say a lot of the emphasis, like we were talking about development early, you know, it has to be on kind of skill development and getting out there and getting repetition. And, you know, the score is great
I'm going to give you a perfect example of that right now. So about 5 years ago, I got heavily involved in the board of minor hockey, and I was not pleased in the direction that I saw, and the negative connotation surrounding hockey in the area. What happened to the hockey in the Miramichi? So I said, well, instead of me grumping and growling at it, I'm going to get more involved. Luckily enough, I joined the board when it was going through some good change. I will give full credit to Michael Berube, who kind of oversaw the changes taking place. Mike was a longstanding board member who stepped away for years and then came back. Since that, and the focus more on skill development at the youngest levels, making sure it was fun for the kids, not about the winning. I will say, in the long run, if you focus on those things, it pays off. For the last 2 years in the North Shore League, both all three Miramichi competitive teams have finished first in the North. All of our District 8 teams have either made it to their finals or won their finals from our local teams. So in the long run, that pays off.
And I think that's the big message we're trying to get across. It's not about the immediate satisfaction of one game. It is the total development of, you know, in this case, the student athlete.
And I will say, locally, our hockey's back on the river. Hockey is back. And look, I look forward to the future and what that means for our high school programs, what it means for the development and the Timberwolves down the road. You're going to see a lot of local talent playing the sport of hockey, where we were sorely lacking that maybe in the last 10 years, local flavor to our teams. You're going to see that back because the talent is there, and it's because of that focus on skill development first. If you focus on that and make it fun, you get more kids playing your game, you retain them in your sport, and ultimately it pays off in the long run, and that's what we want to see. And that's part of the volleyball program here too. I made mention last night of a few major stalwarts in the local Miramichi area in the volleyball scene, one being Carla Dixon from the Nelson Rural School area. Carla is in the Canadian Sports Wall of Fame, the New Brunswick Sports Wall of Fame, and the local Miramichi Sports Wall of Fame, all for her volleyball prowess. She's a two-time All-Canadian in the sport of volleyball at the university level. I know that her and Tony Van Buskirk and Colin Terrio, those are three names that have really tried to grow the sport of volleyball here in the Miramichi. And as you can see, with Dr. Loja having four girls teams and a boys team, we fielded five volleyball teams out of a what we'll call this ourselves a medium-sized middle school.
Yeah, we're 255 kids.
So to field that many teams tells you the interest is there, and if the interest is there, you're going to develop athletes, and that's what it's all about. So we are into our fifth and final set. Now, Mr. Way, will this be to 15 or will this be to the 25?
No, I think this will be to 25.
Okay, I know there was some discussion of that last night, and Mrs. Cable informed me that's a decision between the two coaches. The referee will often ask in the fifth set if they want to play to 15 or to 25. So we'll see here if they play the full 25 or if they decide to go the full 15. I understand a 25, again, more experience for the new players to the game and make sure. Oh, and another soccer maneuver there from Madison Sanborn, and she's having a little chuckle over that.
You know, you like to see that you try something that didn't work, but at the same time, you still have a good attitude about it.
So that is Addison McDonald, grade 6 student, Addison McDonald, with the serve.
You know, I can really notice even from the first set and some of these girls that are on for the sometimes the third time, you can see the confidence starting to get up there.
And let's not forget, there is a big difference between a grade 6 student and a grade 8 student, both developmentally, athletically. There's a size difference there, a strength difference. It's not easy to go out and play against a team of entirely grade 8 students. So kudos to our Tier 2 White Knights for making sure that they're seeing it through.
But, you know, even you alluded to this earlier, sometimes it's not necessarily the focus at the elementary level. So even when they come here to the phys ed program with a Mike McCollum or a John Corlett, or, you know, like last year, our grade sevens, the first time when they go to morning options with a Zach Martin, and they can just be exposed to volleyball. That's a big piece too, is just that exposure to, and finding out that you want to play.
Exactly. And that is that, I'll go back to fielding four girls teams at a relatively moderately sized middle school is a testament to the interest in the sport and the interest in wanting to be a part of your school community and a contributing member to your school overall and in your school life.
You know, I guess one of our things here is we definitely want to be as inclusive as possible for anyone that wants to play. So if we have the numbers to merit a team, you know, kind of regardless of the sport, we're always going to do whatever we can to find a coach and get uniforms and to get people out on the court or the pitch or the field or the ice or whatever it is.
A challenging situation is to make sure you have coaches because the interest is there. It's to have the coaches there as well. And speaking from a person who spends most of the year either in a supporting role or as a head coach or behind the scenes, I can tell you it's not easy, and but it is a rewarding thing to give back to your community as a coach. And I got to experience the better side of that this week with my boys' team winning the District 8 championship, and one of my all-time favorite kids I've ever coached, Ethan Sloan. So if Ethan's listening, Ethan won himself an MVP of the league award.
Oh, that's great to
hear. For his contributions to the team. You will find no better team player than Ethan Sloan, and one of the best kids I've coached in my time coaching.
So we're back here to live action, and I honestly believe that Brooklyn Gregan is trying to destroy the volleyball with her pregame warm-up, because I don't know that there's going to be any air left in after that she does that.
That one just
clips the net
and doesn't quite make it over, and there's been a few of those this game. We're into a tight one here again in the fifth set. It's 12-9. For the Blue Knights, and we have Abigail Nicholson, and that time it does pay off, and look at with the ace. I know that Abigail was struggling a bit with her serve earlier, and it's nice, the confidence. You could hear the crowd, the players on the bench encouraging her, and that's two in a row, a little bit of confidence. So that is that growth we're talking about, Mr. Way, that somebody that was struggling a little bit earlier in the match has now found a little bit of confidence, and look, here it is, three in a row.
Serve.
And 3 points in a row.
Yeah.
And she gets the ball back here. Let's see if she can keep her streak alive here. Look at this. Oh, is that a foot violation?
It's
a foot violation. Stepped over, slightly over the line there with her foot. Good call on the referee, seeing that happen.
Two excellent bumps there.
Mm-hmm. And into the net by Ella Guimond. Couldn't quite get the ball to go over. And we have Emma Peltier. Emma's new to us this year, Mr. Way, correct?
Yeah, coming from the Miramichi Rural School.
Yeah, grade 8 girl, but new to us. Coming down river.
Coming down from the Farewell Buoy.
The Farewell Buoy. Yes, correct. Beautiful area, Miramichi, the Bay of Inn area, the Bay of Inn. I know I'd love to spend parts of my summers down there.
And cottage country. And no parts of your winter.
No parts of your winter. That would not be a spot I'd like to live during the coldest parts of our seasons here on the coast of New Brunswick. But it's a beautiful area. Brooklyn Sargent now with the serve, and I know Brooklyn's had a great serving game. Let's see what she does, and another beautiful serve. A lot of confidence on the line there when Brooklyn Sargent's serving.
But one thing I can notice from the white team is Ella Howe right there. They know that it's going to be an overhand serve, and it's going to be placed well, and they're going after it. They know it's coming.
which is good for that learning curve that we're talking about.
So that was actually out of bounds when Madison returned that. It didn't go across the line. So now we have Elagima going to serve.
Elagima. And just clears the net and gets the point in. I think that the Blue Knights there thought that was going to hit the net and didn't quite go for it, but it does clear. So let's see what she can do with this one. Places it in a little different spot that time, and another point for Ella Guimond. Let's see if she keeps mixing it up here.
So we're at 14 serving 19 here in the fifth set.
Fifth and final set. For those of you watching at home, this is the final set of the match. Ella Guimond with another good serve, but Carly Okoto recognizing that nobody was there on the front line and calmly places it in and gets the point. And now we have Madison Samford serving for the Blue Knights. 27. Hard serve there from Samford. And
with a frozen rope over the top.
That was a little bit unexpected, that one. That's a good serve. Oh, over the net. That's a good set here. Let's see if they can. Okay. Tried to go.
Yeah, I really liked how low that Madison got on that return.
Yes.
She's in total control when she has it.
Yeah. And again, the White Knights are certainly trying for those three hits, Mr. Way. It's just, I think the confidence isn't quite there yet.
Yeah, it's just the nerves and repetition and getting used to those situations.
And some that just barely makes it over, but it does pay off for Samford, and we are down to what could be set point here. Let's see if it happens. Oh, good return.
Oh, great return by Ella Howe. Good sportsmanship.
Yeah, good sportsmanship. She did touch that one, so that is a point for the White Knights to stay alive, to stave off elimination here. So we'll see if Ella Howe can put the ball in play here. And that is no dice on that one, so that ends the match. That is the end of our match between our White Knights and our Blue Knights. Ultimately, it's a 5-0 victory for the more experienced Grade 8 Blue Knights, but a definite good learning experience for our 6-7 girls.
And yeah, I want to let everyone know that we really do. You could really notice the growth of the White Knights. You know, near the end, really trying to take control, trying to get three shots in. It's just a matter. It's one of those good learning experiences. Back to the practice court next week after the Easter weekend. You know, have a discussion, learn from, you know, what you can take out of this and move along to your next opponent.
Okay. So we are going to sign off here. I want to wish everybody a happy Easter weekend. Hopefully you can safely spend time with your family and keep your, we are in the yellow zone here. I'm hoping we can stop saying these colors at some point in the not too distant future. But we are in the yellow phase, so we hope everybody at home enjoys their Easter weekend. But keep with your steady 15 and keep your circle small. And there are brighter days ahead. So we're all hoping that you enjoyed our broadcast here, and we'll see you all next week for what will be a hopefully exciting couple of weeks to come in our boys and girls volleyball season. So for myself, Mr. Keating, and Mr. Way, we thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you all next time.